Hello and welcome to this musical edition of Encore. Today's guest is one of the biggest stars of the Balkans, from making music for movies to composing for Iggy Pop. His unique mix of gypsy brass band beats and orchestral sounds tinged with a rock accent have brought him international acclaim. We'll be talking to Goran Bregovic shortly about his colourful career. But first, let's get a wrap-up of this week's music news. And for that, I'm joined, as always, by our music critic, Mariam Saab. Hello, Mariam. We're going to start with the Black Keys. They've just announced they've released a new album, but did so in a pretty unusual way, didn't they?
Well, Mike Tyson, of all people, broke the news that the Black Keys will be releasing their album Turn Blue May 13th. Now, the boxer tweeted a link to a creepy, almost Lynchian teaser that won't turn you blue, but perhaps a shade of grey. It's unnerving, to say the least. Now, they're already out with their first single. They released the catchy, psychedelic number Fever. It was produced by Danger Mouse. And if it's a sign of what's to come, it's surely not going to disappoint fans who've waited 3 years for a new release. Now, let's take a look at the trailer and the song Fever.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. You will obey my each and every word. I am inside you now.
Certainly pretty trippy. What do you think, Goran? Have you been put under the Black Keys spell?
Oh, it's good, you know. It's not easy nowadays to have some attention on this mess, on internet, on everywhere. So,
yeah,
I like it.
You need to build hype, and they've got a few big dates coming up. They'll be headlining the Latitude Festival in July and performing in Glastonbury in June. So,
all right, Mary. Well, another highly anticipated album is the latest offering from the Wu Tang Clan. But this is something that not everyone's actually going to have the chance to hear, will they?
Absolutely. It will never be streamed online, and you can't buy it from iTunes. And if you want to pick one up from the shops, you can't do that either. In fact, there will only be one physical copy of the album, and most of us will never get our hands on it because it's going to be locked away in a Moroccan vault, but not forever. The group do plan to tour the album around festivals, museums, and galleries, and there you can listen to the new songs, but only on headphones. And once that's said and done, they're going to be auctioning off the album, and they hope to pick up millions for that. But it's not just a gimmick, if that's what you're both thinking. It's a statement as well. The Wu-Tang Clan say they want to elevate music back to the form of high art.
Certainly a different approach, isn't it? All right, well, another group that's got an album out are the English rockers, the Kaiser Chiefs. Now, Marion, this is their fifth studio album, but it sounds more like a debut. How is that possible?
Well, it's a rebirth, essentially. The group have come together again after their main songwriter, Nick Hodgson, quit last year, and he's also their drummer. Now they've got Vijay Mistry from the band Clubsmith on drums, and lead singer Ricky Wilson says the band has a new sense of purpose following this little split. And despite being a very British record, it was recorded in America, and as the saying goes, a change of scenery does a person good. But in this case, I'm not sure I agree. I think the band have lost their way a little bit on this record, but we'll let you be the judge. Here's a clip of Coming Home.
Marion, well, the album's called Education, Education, Education and War. With a name like that, it sounds like they're trying to make some kind of political statement or something.
Well, you would think so, given the fact that the album name does come from a 1996 soundbite by Tony Blair. And lyrically, the album itself is quite angry. The songs portray a portrait of a modern dystopia with lines about factories, battlefields and loneliness, but despite this, we can't get the lead singer, Ricky Wilson, to really own the album's politics. When asked about it, he's only deflected, saying he wanted the album, in fact, to be the unofficial anthem of the World Cup, and he doesn't want to change the world, he says. He just wants to make people dance, which is quite funny that he doesn't really own up to
that.
What
do you think? Your latest album, Champagne for Gypsies, many have said it's regarded as a protest record for the Roma. Do you think that music is a good medium for getting a message across or giving people a voice?
You know, there is a long road to illuminate the better world. So even small lights helps. I don't think, of course, that any record could change the world. But, like, you know, small lights helps.
What is it about the Roma and the plight of those people that draws you to?
Well, you know, if you can witnessing again the bad moments for the gypsies in Europe now. They throw them out from France, from Italy. On the east is terrible as usually. So this my album. I invited some of my favorite gypsy artists. It's just to remind us that gypsies left strong traces in mm-hmm. our culture. So from generation of gypsy kings and Stefan Eicher till Gogol Bordello, I have some really good guests on this record.
Absolutely.
Goran, let's go back to the beginning of your career now. You started out with the violin. You were expelled from school while you were playing the violin. Then you went on to study philosophy. Now, was your move from the study halls to the rock stages also an act of rebellion on your part?
I started very early. I started as a striptease bar musician, you know, in communist.
Wow.
It was good. I mean, I saw more naked women in the age of 17 than all kids in Yugoslavia together, I think. But in communist times, striptease bars were not only about naked women. They were places where you can see artists and kind of cultural place in that time. And then I in Italy, I was already in the age of 18. I had problems with drugs. So I promised to my mom, I'm not going to play anymore. So okay. The study of philosophy was kind of refuge for my mom. And then on the last year of university, I did my first record. And I saved from this destiny of teaching philosophy to the kids. Because on that time I supposed to be professor of Marxism. It was.
And you thought, no, you're too rock for that.
I felt even sorry for the kids in the age of 16, really, to fall down in philosophy. It's too early.
All right. Well, before we go any further, let's give the viewers a taste now of you in action. This is one of your live shows here in Paris last year, performing the song Bella Ciao.
And dance. Now, Goran, one of your more talked about collaborators, Iggy Pop, was actually handed your record by Martin Scorsese, US film director, after he was completely spellbound after hearing your score on Serbian film director Emir Kusturica's film Time of the Gypsies. How important has film been for your career, especially your work with Kusturica?
I had the luck to work on his three best movies during 10 years. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, I gave him my best, he gave me his best. And it was, you know, a nice period of lifetime.
What was it like collaborating with Iggy Pop?
Oh, he was in opposite period of what how we imagine Iggy Pop. He has Japanese wife, cat, dog. We even recorded in Philip Glass studio. He asked me, please don't go in studio where the technicians smoke joints all the time. But it was a very cool period.
Since 1998, you've been performing with the Wedding and Funeral Band, with the Wedding and Funeral Orchestra, rather. What does the ensemble, which is mainly brass, strings and pipes, bring to your live show?
It's a mixture of highly educated musicians and musicians that barely can read and write. So it gives some... because I can't really play only with musicians who read partitions. It doesn't have a sense. So it must be a little balance between discipline and anarchy if I like to enjoy music.
What is it about gypsy music that draws you to it?
Well, I'm not the only composer in history who was impressed and influenced by gypsy music. You will find this almost to any big composers in history of music. It's this unexplainable talent to play music, to make music. I don't know how to explain this.
Mm-hmm. And the anarchy, as you were saying,
It must be some freedom for them to enjoy it.
Okay. Well, we have to leave it there, I'm afraid, but thank you so much, Goran, for coming in to speak with us. Just a reminder that you can catch Goran on tour and see him performing here in Paris as part of the Chorus Festival on the 1st of April. Thanks also to our music critic, Mariam Saab, of course. Before we go, we're going to leave you with a clip of Goran Bregovic playing with the Gypsy Kings. This is Balkaneros. Enjoy and see you for more culture news soon.
Balkan, Balkan, Balkan! ¡Eh, Balcañeros! ¡Vamos!